and welcome to Per la Victoire. You may have seen that I wear cartridge pleated skirts pretty often on my channel. Today I'll walk you through sewing your own historically accurate cartridge pleated skirt. Cartridge pleating is one of my favorite historical sewing techniques, and while it must be done by hand, it's an easy and meditative process. Cartridge pleating is a method of sewing parallel rows of stitches to create tight, even gathers, and appears in dresses from the 16th and 17th centuries, 1840s, 1850s, and 1860s, and in some regional or folk costumes. I have a strong interest in Portuguese folk costumes, so I'll be making the skirt in this video based on photos and original pieces from Portugal in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. However, the techniques in this video are applicable to mid-Victorian skirts, other regions, history bounding, cottage core, or other costumes in which you need to gather a lot of fabric into a waistband. To start, you'll need 3.5 yards of fabric that is 42 to 45 inches wide. This will give you a skirt with a finished circumference of about 126 inches, or 3.5 yards. For metric folks, this is 3.2 meters of fabric to create a three-paneled skirt with a finished circumference of 3.2 meters. If you're using a 50 to 55 inch wide fabric, you'll need 2.5 yards or 2.3 meters of fabric and your skirt will have two panels. I find a skirt with more than 4 yards or 3.6 meters in circumference becomes quite heavy, and a skirt with a circumference of 2 yards or 1.8 meters feels more like a petticoat and doesn't swoosh as nicely. I'm 5 foot 4 inches tall and creating an ankle length skirt, so if you're taller, you'll need a bit more fabric. You will also need some scrap fabric for the hem facing and, optional but recommended, tape to bind the hem. I'll go into more detail on that later. I'm using a printed cotton fabric. This one happens to be a reproduction print from 1870 to 1890. This method will also work for light and midweight wool and silk fabrics. My skirt will be made of 3 panels of fabric. To calculate how tall each panel should be, I measured from my waist to my ankle, 39 inches or 100 centimeters, added 2.5 inches or 6 centimeters for the turning under for the cartridge pleats, and added seam allowance for the hem for a total panel height of 42.5 inches or 108 centimeters. Many cotton fabrics like this one can be torn across the grain. I'm cutting off the selvages of my fabric since they're large and stiff. If your fabric has a nice small selvage, you can keep it intact. I pinned the panels together, leaving 10 inches or 26 centimeters unpinned at one seam. This will become the opening of the skirt. In hindsight, I could have made this opening a bit longer. I sewed the panels together and pressed down the seam allowances. This particular fabric doesn't fray that much, so I'll leave the raw edges as they are, although you can fell down or pink the seam allowances. During the mid and late 19th century and early 20th century, skirts had a protective strip of fabric sewn to the inside called a hem facing. The hem facing would experience most of the wear and tear. Shoes would rub against it, dirt from the streets would collect on it, and when the hem facing was too worn, it was removed and replaced with a fresh strip of fabric. For this skirt's facing, I'm using 3 strips of 45 inch wide printed cotton fabric. Side note, the gingham print on this fabric is slightly wonky, so if it looks like my facing is ever crooked, it's not, that's just the print. I made sure my strips were on grain by tearing the fabric. Each strip is 8 inches tall. Original garments show hem facings that range from 5 to 10 inches tall. I also cut off the selvage edges from the facing pieces. I sewed the strips for the facing together to create one long strip. I pinned the strip right sides together onto the skirt, lining up the raw edges. I folded in a 1/2 inch seam allowance on one end of the strip. Then I sewed the strip to the bottom of the skirt on the sewing machine. Where the ends of the strips meet, I trimmed off the excess overlapping fabric. I usually adjust the width of my hem facing at this stage rather than when I'm sewing the strips together. Then I sewed the remainder of the facing to the bottom of the skirt. Press the seam, then flip out the facing and press again. For the upper raw edge of the facing, you can leave it as is, cut the edge with pinking shears, or press down a small seam allowance like I'm doing here. This cotton fabric frayed a bit and I didn't want fraying threads all over the inside of my skirt. I pressed the seam allowances of the skirt and facing towards the facing. Yes, a lot of the process of sewing is actually done at the ironing board, but it's worth it for that crisp look. Now the facing is ready to be flipped to the inside of the skirt and stitched down. I like to leave a little bit of the skirt fabric showing on the inside. This will be covered by a protective binding later. Pin the top edge of the facing to the skirt. The facing can then be sewn down by machine or by hand. I chose to hand stitch mine for this project because a horizontal line of visible machine stitches would disrupt the vertical design of the fabric print. If you're working with a plaid fabric, you can easily hide the machine stitching in the plaid. There are many examples of Portuguese skirts decorated with bands of trim or ribbon. Perhaps these decorations disguise the stitches of the facing? I sewed my facing on with a single thread in a coordinating color. I started by whip stitching the unsewn edges of the facing together. I used a running stitch with more of the stitch on the inside of the skirt so that the stitching would appear nearly invisible from the outside of the skirt. This construction process is appropriate for skirts of the 1840s, 1850s, and early 1860s. You start by finishing the hem entirely and then adjust and fit the skirt at the waist. If you're making a skirt with a curved hem, like an Edwardian walking skirt, you can cut your hem facing strips on the bias or cut them curved to match the curved hem of the skirt. For extra protection, a binding is applied over the bottom edge of the skirt. I'm using a plain woven black cotton tape, which I'll link down below, but you can also use a twill tape or a fabric binding. Historically, hems were bound with wool tape or braid, but these can be expensive and difficult to find. Bias strips of velveteen fabric were used in the 1890s and early 1900s on some skirts. Like the hem facing, the binding would be removed when it became too worn out to protect the hem of the skirt. There are a few ways you can attach the binding. You can fold it in half and sandwich the skirt hem within it. You can also offset the fold so that more of the binding is on the inside of the skirt. I'll link a video below that analyzes hem braid on extant garments and shows different methods of applying it. You can also stitch the binding to the outside of the skirt and then flip it to the inside and stitch again, which is what I chose to do with this skirt. I folded in the raw edge of my cotton tape and then sewed it to the bottom of my skirt with a simple running stitch. I'm sewing pretty close to the edge of the fabric. Of course, the binding can be sewn by machine, but that will make it harder to eventually remove. Like we did for the hem facing, I overlap the other raw edge of the binding over the folded edge to conceal these edges. Some extant examples show that they just left the binding edges exposed and fraying. Then I press the binding down and flip it to the inside of the skirt. I secure it with more large running stitches. I found that these plastic quilting clips were really helpful in holding the folded binding in place. And with that, the bottom of the skirt is complete and we can move on to the main attraction, the cartridge pleating. First, we'll finish off the skirt opening. If your fabric has a nice selvage, you can just stitch down the selvage. You could also make an actual placket with an overlap, but for this particular project being a rural woman's skirt, I decided to use this simple finish. I fold it down 2.5 inches or 6 centimeters at the top of the skirt, and then fold it in the raw edges near the skirt opening. I sewed down the raw edges with a whip stitch. I might go back and make the opening of the skirt longer. It's important to account for the amount of fabric you need to fold down for the cartridge pleats. This folded down fabric adds depth and thickness to the pleats and creates a finished edge at the top of the pleats. Doing the parallel rows of gathering stitches without turning down the top edge of the fabric was called stroke gathering and was often used on undergarments. You can check out my Victorian petticoats video tutorial to learn more. I then pressed down the 2.5 inches or 6 centimeters along the top edge of the skirt. To sew the pleats, I use heavier weight thread. This is Tex 40 Mara 70 by Guterman. You can see how it's a bit thicker than regular sewing thread. I strengthen my thread by running it through beeswax and pressing it between paper to seal the wax. The key feature of cartridge pleating is the parallel even rows of stitches. You can choose to mark each stitch line or not. I find it helpful to at least mark the horizontal rows with chalk. I prefer to do 3 rows of stitches. I also experiment with how far apart to make the stitches and rows. Thicker fabrics can have longer stitches, thinner fabrics like this cotton or a silk can have shorter stitches. I ended up placing my rows 1/2 inch or 1.3 centimeters apart, and my stitches 1/4 inch or 0.6 centimeters apart. Do a few practice stitches to see what works best on your fabric. I like to secure my thread with a few back stitches next to the skirt opening. I'm using a single thread that's about the length of my arm on my needle. The stitches are simple running stitches. You can use 2 or 3 threaded needles to sew the rows, as in 1 needle dedicated to each row, but I prefer to use 1 needle and switch between threads. Here, I'm just following the pattern of the stitches above. Over, under, over, under, it's kind of meditative. Check out my 1840s dress video to see me sew lots of tiny cartridge pleats where I held a ruler as I sewed to get precise stitches. I'll link that video down below along with all the images and resources I used for this video. Your thread won't be long enough to sew the pleats in one go, so once you reach the end of your thread for every row, hold the threads tightly and push the fabric down the length of the threads. This gathers the fabric into the distinct pleats. Then you have a long length of thread available again, and you can keep sewing your rows. Repeat this process several times. For me, it's so satisfying to see the fabric scrunch up into the cartridge pleats, like a little progress reward after all the hand sewing. When you've pleated all your fabric, don't tie off or permanently secure your thread ends, as you may need to adjust the tightness of the gathers when sewing the skirt to a waistband or tape. The finished pleats are three-dimensional and appear like stacked folds when viewed from above. Now that we have the basic preparation done, we can take this in a few different directions. We can keep the pleats as is, or press them flat for perfectly even knife pleats. This might be especially helpful if you're making a late 18th century gown. You can sew the pleats to the bottom of a bodice, which is how mid-19th century dresses were made. Another option, which appears in Portuguese folk skirts, is to sew a tape along the top edge of the pleats, forming a waistband, with the ends of the tape extending past the skirt opening so that you can tie the skirt on. Here, I'm attaching a length of cotton tape to the outside of the skirt with whip stitches. When I get to the skirt opening, I fold the tape over to the inside and whip stitch it down. This was the method used on this antique Portuguese skirt in my collection, with nearly invisible stitches on the outside and very visible stitches on the inside. I prefer the feeling of a fitted waistband, which is what I'll add to this skirt. I cut a strip of fabric 3 inches or 7.5 centimeters wide and 30 inches or 75 centimeters long. That is my waist circumference plus an inch seam allowance plus 3 inches for the waistband to overlap. I like my waistbands to have a generous overlap so that I can adjust the placement of the pleats if I change sizes. The waistband is folded in half lengthwise, right sides together, and one short edge and the long edge are sewn by machine. I trim and clip the seam allowances, then turn the waistband right side out and finish the open end with whip stitches. I didn't add any interfacing on my waistband, so to give it extra strength and stiffness, I topstitched around the edge on my sewing machine. I marked 1.5 inches or 3.8 centimeters on each end of the waistband for my overlap. I like my skirts to fasten right over left, so on the left side of my waistband, I'll align the top of the skirt to the marking I just did. Place the waistband seam side up along the outside of the cartridge pleats. On the right side, the waistband edge aligns with the skirt opening. With matching wax thread, stitch through the waistband into the fold of a pleat. Stitch again for extra security, then move on to the next pleat, whip stitching each valley of a pleat to the waistband. You may have to adjust the closeness of the pleats to match the length of your waistband. After the pleats have been attached to the waistband, fold up the waistband to see your beautifully three-dimensional pleats. Then sew on your closure of choice. I like these flat hooks, but I know they're more modern. I'm just trying to use up the supplies I have. At this point, try on the skirt and secure the threads from the cartridge pleats. I usually leave the bottom rows a bit looser than the top row so that the pleating can fan out over my hips. You can also decorate the pleats with embroidery, cross stitches, back stitches, or smocking. I quickly experimented with a few designs here, but if you choose to do this, use embroidery floss rather than regular sewing thread like I did. With different colored threads, you can make floral and geometric designs. I think a skirt like this is the perfect blank canvas project. You can take it in many different directions, see what cool effects you can get by pleating a plaid or striped fabric, add pockets, add trim. It's also a great way to practice historical sewing techniques. I personally love wearing these skirts for history banding and hobbit core outfits. I hope this video is helpful and inspires you to make your own cartridge pleated skirt. If you made a skirt using this tutorial, I'd love to see it. Feel free to tag me or message me on Instagram. If you enjoyed this video, please leave a like and comment down below and subscribe to see more. Thank you so much for watching.